Oh, there it is, Austin. Yes. Good morning, everybody. Good to have you all here this morning at 11:11 celebration. We're going to go ahead and get started. We usually have folks continue trickling in here for the next 5-10 minutes, but we need to get started. We have a big morning, and we've got a great guest artist with us this morning. We have Hannah Kirby here, and we're so excited to have her. We had a big crowd in here at the first service, and she was amazing. We're so glad to have Hannah Kirby with us. I won't say any more. You'll get it for yourself. But I do want to make a couple of announcements and make sure you're aware of that before they start playing the first song. Turn over your bulletin. Make sure you're registering your attendance. Make sure you've done that. Register the card. Scan it if you want to try that and sign online. But we want to know that you're here. And if you've been visiting with us, make sure you put that on there and give it to us so we can kind of keep up with you, let you know. We got D.C. Cornish, a storyteller, coming in a couple of weeks. Some of y'all remember him when he was here before and told us that wonderful civil rights story from our local area. And then we'll have Jakey Cabe doing some more stuff. And we just keep you informed if we can get you on our mailing list. On the back of the bulletin, a couple of highlight things. I won't go over all of them. There's plenty. I've highlighted these before. I want to mention two things. The Story Arc Ministry. We've always done this kind of quietly and then puts the stories online, but I wanted you to know that we have this ministry where we create stories, three-minute stories out of personal experiences. We work them together in a shared group that's a really wonderful interpersonal kind of group of support. Not a therapeutic kind of thing, but a thing where we learn to really fine-tune an emotion, a powerful story in our lives, like maybe an epiphanal moment or maybe a moment where we experience beauty. And these become, they're personal stories, and these become three-minute narratives that we fine-tune as a group. So it's almost a writing thing. But then, if you're interested, the second phase of that is to take it and create a digital video version of that with audio background and with digital imagery and pictures and that sort of thing. And that's a little bit more lengthy process. That's why we split it into two parts. You can go online on the website, look up Story Arc at the church website, and you'll see we have about 5 or 6 there. If you're interested, I hope you'll sign up for that because it's a lot of fun, a lot of great insight, and it's, you really create a really nice product at the end. The other thing is on September 22nd this week is Texas Giving Day, North Texas Giving Day. I really hope that you'll consider doing a donation. You're doing one of your regular donation to the church you might do on that day. The cool thing about that as well is that 10% of that, and am I correct on that? That 10%, there's actually a 10% matching to that. Do you know about that? Okay, so you have a matching grant with the church's mission, right?
Right, the mission. One of our volunteers donated.
Okay, yeah, but in addition to that, the North Texas, any donations that are made. Okay, cool. Yeah, but it will. They'll also bump it an extra 10%. At least is what I heard from some other charitable groups. So anyway, it's a good time to give and to consider making a gift. So keep that in mind. The link is right there. You can get more information. All right, so I think that's it for now. Oh, no, almost forgot. Do you all remember DeAndrea Dare? I'm sure you know DeAndrea. DeAndrea, our young minister who has been helping out in here and has a nonprofit for families who've lost children. She had a baby yesterday. So we're very excited for her. Mara Grace was born, and there's a lot of anxiety that led up to this, of course, because she's lost a child before, and this is a beautiful little girl, 9 pounds, 9.5 pounds. Yeah, so, and you know, she's like this big, you know, so. Anyway, we're very excited for her, and we celebrate with her on that as well. So good to have you all here. Let's begin.
Keep this world from dragging me down.
So this morning we're thinking of this idea of I'm not that. All the different ways we try to understand ourselves in relationship to God, in relationship to God's kingdom, and that sort of idea of being a spiritual refugee in search of home. There's this aspect today I want to think with you about spiritual but not religious. But I want to think with you about what it is that we're defiant about. Sometimes we're defiant. We won't back down in ways that are quite possessive, in ways that are quite self-focused. And in other ways, we're defiant when it comes to justice and others. What kind of defiance, how do we define ourselves in that way? I'm going to think about that this morning as well. I invite you to stand up, and we'll have a prayer, and then we'll open with a song and bring your offerings forward. Let's have a word of prayer. Holy One, we are grateful this morning for this chance to be together in celebration, to be together in openness with one another, this interesting and curious space that we enter into every Sunday that gives us this opportunity, this invitation to be open. We are grateful for all the weather and the changes. We're grateful for each moment of our lives. But this morning, open us up that we might be mindful of what it is we're called to be defiant about. Bless us, and we give thanks in the name of the one whom we live and move and have our being. Amen. So this song, Come Dance, one of our great songs that Charles Gaby wrote, and we're going to sing that. But if you brought an offering, I hope you did, bring it forward. And also, if you register your attendance, bring that forward. Let's sing. Probably mine.
There are no steps to this sacred dance, just the feel of your feet on the floor. Arms in the air, as free as your birth, and as simple as a wave on the shore.
Yeah, barely a treatment. That's
the
right.
Voices you heard, and
exactly.
Now we're here, find a rhythm that fits how you live. Silence the critical voices inside us and strain our lives to a sin. God of pleasure and wilderness, grant us the means to dance with creation. God of wonder and bliss, give us love for the beauty of all our relations. As we stretch out our hands to the heavens so fair, let this dance be our prayer.
two, here we go.
We move in the mystery of all that we see. We dance for the wonder of thee. We dance through the struggles to remind us how the truth is finally free. God of pleasure and wilderness, grant us the wisdom to dance with creation. God of wonder and bliss, give us love for the beauty of all our relation. As we stretch out our hands to the heavens so fair, let this dance be our prayer. Come, sisters and mothers, and let down your hair. Come, stars of the morning and darkest of night, for the joy of creation's God's greatest delight. God of pleasure and wilderness, grant us the wisdom to dance with creation. God of wonder and bliss, give us love for the beauty of all our stretch out our hands to the heavens so fair. God of pleasure and wilderness, grant us the wisdom to dance with creation. God of wonder and bliss, give us love for the beauty of all our relations. Stretch out our hands to the heavens so fair.
Everybody take a moment and offer one another a sign of peace, would you please?
Pressing on. Yes, I'm pressing on. Well, I'm pressing on to the higher calling of my Lord. Well, I'm pressing on. On. Yes, I'm pressing on to the higher calling of my Lord. Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm pressing on. Yeah, I'm pressing on. Yeah. trying to try to stop me. Shake me up in my mind. Say, prove to me that he's the Lord. Show me a sign. What kind of sign they need when it all comes from within? When what's lost has been found, what's to come has already been. I just keep pressing on. Yeah, I'm pressing on. Yeah, I'm pressing on to the higher calling of my Lord. Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm pressing on.
Good ring. We come now to our Kairos moment. And you all know when we do this, usually we kind of have a time of solemn reflection. Well, let me just call a timeout on that one and say, this Kairos moment that we celebrate each week, this time between what just happened and what's going to happen and we don't know what it is a good thing to do all the time. Because we often need to pause, right? We need to recalibrate our compassion and our empathy muscles. We need to reset the brain. And so we do that here because it's good to do it here, but also because we're going to need to do it out there. But sometimes when we pause, like right now, after that great music, it's not exactly a time for solemn reflection. But it's still a time to pause. And so I'm going to invite you today to don't close your eyes like I usually ask you to. Keep your eyes wide open, even as we are quiet together. And don't be embarrassed. Just look around. Sometimes it's so noisy, you can't see. You can't see. So look. Look all around you. Don't be embarrassed. Move your head around the room. Maybe you'll see how the light glances through the wispy ivory curtains. Keep looking with new eyes. These are not the same eyes you had a minute ago. And maybe the color in the carpet might not be your style, might not be your color, but the reds are reds, the greens are greens. Somewhere in time, somebody came up with this design. Somebody invented how you dye stuff and weave stuff, and So keep looking around. What do you see? For sure, you see these amazing people sitting all around you. Every one of them bursting at the seams with their wonderfulness. Every one of them like you, breathing, bleeding, crying, dreaming. Every one of them like you, having done something really hard and they made it. Every one of them like you, with desires and hopes and losses. Look at these wonderful people right here with you and me. Don't be shy. Look at them. They're bursting at the seams with wonderfulness. Mary Oliver said, "When I die, I want it to be said that I was a bride to amazement." May it be so for all of us.
Good morning. So the reading this morning is Mark 10, 17 through 22. I don't know why I always get breathless when I'm up here. I'm not nervous. As Jesus continued down the road, a man ran up, knelt before him, and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to earn eternal life?" Jesus replied, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except the one God. You know the commandments. Don't commit murder. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't give false testimony. Don't cheat. Honor your father and your mother." "Teacher," he responded, "I've kept all of these things since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him carefully and loved him. He said, "You are lacking one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor. Then you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." But the man was dismayed at this statement and went away, saddened, because he had many possessions.
Hannah, what is your phone saying? Okay. I'm just curious. I was like, now I want to know what it's saying. We have phones go off all the time, and mine is a duck that quacks, and it goes off all the time too, which is why it's sitting in my office. So I want to think about this guy that this idea of spiritual but religious, I mean spiritual but not religious, is a phrase we hear a lot. You probably hear it a lot when you're just passing by folks that you may work with. Maybe some of your friends, maybe family members, you know, depending on how aggressively evangelical you might be, you might even hear it more from other people. You know, I'm spiritual but not religious. It's not an uncommon phrase, and some of us even might identify with that idea as well. It's a phrase that I hear a lot from a friend of mine who I've come to know over the years, and we're more of an acquaintance, but I'll even tell you his name because I want you all to go there. I mean, I love the Growler Station at Central Market. Some of you not familiar with the Growler Station, it's the beer station where the beer are on tap, the specialty beers are on tap, and I've become a beer snob. The cyclists yesterday when we were cycling with the Fit Group discovered he's also a coffee snob. And because they served me, they poured the espresso drink. I asked for an iced latte. They took the latte, made a hot latte, and then poured it over ice, which is a no-no. And then, of course, it doesn't do anything but melt the ice, which means you add more ice. So it ends up being water with the tiniest flavor of caffeine in it, you know. And so it's, you know, I wasn't mad or anything at all. I just went and I just kind of instructed them on how you make an iced latte. And so I am a snob. I know it. And I try not to be. I was friendly. I just didn't want them to make that mistake with other patrons in the future. And so I go to the growler station because every now and then, you know, I like to just try some new craft brews and stuff. And Miles, who's one of the growler station guys there, if you all ever go to the Central Market, you know Miles. Next time you go, say Tom says hi. I've been talking to Miles for years. I've been going there for a couple of years. I keep saying, one of these days you're going to come visit 1111. But he always says the same thing. He's always like, no, you know, it's not me. I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious. You know, I don't darken the doors of a church. And then we get into discussions of religion, which, of course, like so many of those scenarios, is completely off base and unrelated to where I am here or where we are in this community, for example. You know, or those experiences where, like, when you're riding on an airplane and somebody says, what do you do for a living? And I just avoid at all costs saying, I'm a minister. Because it immediately has this response of either, you know, these confessions, that's, you know, something horrible, you know, or it's like, oh, I go to church. I haven't been to church. Like, I'm a Sunday school attendant, you know, keeper. I haven't been to church in a long, long time. And it's like, I don't really care, you know. But so I don't even go there. Instead, I just open up with story. We just talk about story. And if it comes up that I'm a minister, then oftentimes it's always a surprise. And isn't that interesting that it would be a surprise as opposed to if I just started off with it? So this idea of spiritual but not religious. And I want to read to you something that I read from a book not too long ago that I've been reading. A couple of books I want to talk about today that I've been reading. This one out of Oxford University Press is written by Robert Fuller 2 years ago in 2014, 15. It's called Spiritual But Not Religious. And here's what he describes. He says, a large number of Americans identify themselves as spiritual but not religious. It's likely that maybe one in every five persons, roughly half of all the unchurched, would describe themselves in this way. This phrase probably means different things to different people, but the confusion stems from the fact that the words spiritual and religious are really synonymous. Both connote the idea of belief in a higher power or of some kind of otherness, of a God or a being, a reality. Both also imply a desire to connect or enter into some kind of more experiential understanding of whatever that being is, that reality is. And then finally, both connote an interest in some sort of rituals and practices or moral behaviors that connect, that foster such a connection. So before the 20th century, religious and spiritual were used more or less interchangeably, but now, because of a number of intellectual and scientific progressions over the last decades, and because of this notion because of modern biblical scholarship, and just a greater awareness of our multicultural reality that we live in, sort of a cultural relativism almost, in terms of our own culture in the United States. Because of all of that, this idea of loyalty to a specific religious institution, for some people apparently, is unappealing. It's, in some sense, like even with someone like Miles, kind of repulsive, kind of like, why would I want to do that? That's archaic. It's institutional. It doesn't relate to the real world. I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious. And I have some specific problems with this, and they center around what I would call the difference between stories that are based in our ego and stories that are based more in our soul. And to kind of just help us get there, I want to remind you of the 70s. I'm going to get Lori to come up and sing this. I dumped this on her like an hour and a half ago. And you all will know this song. A lot of you will know this song. Perhaps you've even said this prayer in your own life at some point.
Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches, I must make amends. I work So Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? Oh Lord, won't you buy me a color TV? Dialing for dollars is trying to find me.
I wait for delivery each
day until 3.
Oh Lord, won't you buy me a color TV? Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz?
My friends all drive Porsches,
I must make amends.
Worked hard all my lifetime,
no help from my friends.
Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz?
Oh, nice, nice. How many times is our spirituality really about our ego? Our spiritual identity really about how we see ourselves in deference to someone else? How many times, even the most open of us, find ourselves defensive about who we are in relation to who others are? Come into a space like this and, well, sometimes this isn't your cup of tea. Sometimes this seems a little strange. Maybe we'll do a little prayer to the four winds and get all Native American on some of you. And then you're going to go, oh my God, what is happening in there? I mean, how many times do we define ourselves as against someone else? It's interesting to me that even though that's rather tongue-in-cheek to have this prayer, it's no different than saying God believes like I believe. God doesn't like the people I don't like. God thinks the people that scare me are scary people. You know, I mean, it's not that different. Spiritual but not religious runs that risk, even though I understand, and we all would understand the connotation of where rigidity that's associated sometimes with religious institutions limits sort of what the gospel is all about. That there sometimes creeds and rigid belief systems become defense systems as opposed to invitational systems. Sometimes our religious understanding is so small we miss the largeness of the kingdom. It's not that hard to understand to see that spiritual but religious still can miss the point. Now, it's not to say there's also a lot of good that happens in the church. I forgot to mention also that you know, and this, well, First Methodist, first of all, I would want to say is an amazing church anyway. I mean, I wouldn't be here, we wouldn't be here, if this one's just one of the most amazing institutional churches, part of a traditional Methodist church. It's very progressive, it's very open, and there's such diversity in terms of opportunities for reaching out to those who are in need, as well as reaching out to those who are seeking more understanding of faith and meaning in life. There's just so many different things. It's a great old and dynamic church. But there's something about spirituality that also runs the risk of becoming limited because it forgets something. When people say, I'm not spiritual, I'm spiritual but I'm not religious, I know what they're running from, but what are they running to? Because more often than not, it's also another very small self-oriented narrative. I'm going to find my connection to God. I'm going to find my connection. You know, I'm going to experience something amazing out in the woods, which is kind of creepy if you don't think about it if you think in the wrong way. But I'm going to experience God in nature, which you can, no question about that. But it still misses something that our story today suggests. Which is why this story, I think, sometimes gets so focused on, it's about stewardship, or it's about giving, or it's about caring for the poor. It's about some of that, but it's more than just that. The very notion that spirituality is a private matter, you know what? I keep thinking I'm going to do this, and I keep forgetting to do this. Coming up here because I can't see anybody on the back rows. I want to make sure that I haven't put you to sleep yet. The very notion that the spirituality is something we do private misses the point. The very notion that the church is something that is structured around creeds or belief systems also misses the point, because both of them are basically ego stories. Both of them are basically stories that are around defining boundaries. And what Jesus says here to this fella is that, okay, here are the rules. You do the rules, so what's the problem? And the problem is that he's tied down. There's something that he needs to let go of, that he needs to get undone in order to be open to God's kingdom. I was reading this book called Assimilate or Go Home, Notes from a Failed Missionary on Discovering Faith. I've met this woman, this young woman, D.L. Mayfield, and I invite you to read this book. It's a great book, Assimilate or Go Home, which I love the title even. But D.L. Mayfield was one of the participants at this workshop that Linda and I went to in New Mexico two months ago. And it was put on by Image Magazine, which is mostly a Catholic organization-sponsored journal, but it's very progressive. And the participants in this particular workshop were also quite progressive, but still very diverse. I mean, there were Church of the Brethren, there were Pentecostal participants, there were non-denominational, and then some Methodists. There's about 30 of us in this particular class on spirituality and writing. And the thing for me was, then in dealing with my own ego stories, was just how intimidating this group was. These folks were in their 20s and 30s. There were a few of us in our 50s, and then a few, maybe one or two over that. But a third of them already had books published. And they already had books with Harper One or with Baker Publishing or whoever. And this one young woman who sat off to the side, I am going to just be honest with you. I looked at her and my prejudice came forward and I thought, well, there's another young adult who thinks they know everything about the world. And they're going to basically change the world and I'm obsolete and I'm already feeling completely insignificant. The reality of that narrative is so selfish. It's so self-focused. It's so self-determined. And where do those narratives come from? Where do we get those narratives? And who knows if someone from one of the other participants wasn't sitting there and thinking, I have all the answers and I am in control of the destiny of humankind. But maybe so. Where do those narratives come from? You know, the funny thing about them is 9 times out of 10, we're wrong in our assumptions. She was one of the most amazing people I've ever met. We've gotten to be good Facebook friends and communicate. She wrote this book called Assimilate or Go Home. She was a member of the Brethren Church, and she said her long-term goal had always been, her parents were involved as pastors and such, and her long-term goal had always been to be a missionary. And so as the story unfolds, she decides she's invited by her church to pursue that vocation that God had called her to do, to convert Muslims in the Portland area to Christianity. And she was so excited. I mean, you know, Portland is like a suburb of San Francisco. It's like the den of iniquity, right? I mean, it's just, you know, she knew that this place was just filled with all sorts of problems, and she couldn't wait to convert these people to Christianity. And there was a movie that was being passed around. It's been around since the 1970s, called The Jesus Film. And it's been in 1,200 different languages and shown all over the world, and 5 million, maybe tens of millions of people have come to Jesus because of this film. So, the idea, of course, being that they're showing them in different cultures around the world. My own uncle participated in this project years and years and years ago with the Quiche Indians of northern Mexico. She was so excited. She got an apartment complex in a pretty challenging sort of seedy part of town. It was a low-income area, low-income housing, and refugees from Somali refugees and refugees from Burma that's where they would find themselves in Portland. That was kind of like the community where they would end up. And so this whole apartment complex was filled with these Muslim refugees. And so she decided to throw a party to sort of invite everyone into this large room where she would show the film, and then they would have prayer, and then there would be all of these Muslims who would convert to Christianity. And everything was going according to plan. She sent out invitations. She was surprised at how friendly the Muslims were to her. And they all brought food, and they all gathered in this big community room. And she sold this film. And the first problem she came across was it was in the wrong language. So she starts showing the film, but there's nothing she can do at this point. It's in the wrong language. It's a different dialect. It's Arabic. Somebody thought, well, they're Muslim. It must be Arabic. And so it was in Arabic. And she said the whole time she was watching them, she was surprised still that they still paid attention to it. They didn't didn't get distracted. At the very end, around the point in the film where Jesus is crucified, they actually kind of started getting distracted and going to some other things. A few got up and went over and got food prepared on the tables. And then after the movie was over, she completely fell apart internally. She thought, I have totally messed up as a missionary. This did not work at all. And this is where the story essentially begins. She said, as I just started to fall apart, several of them came forward and spoke in their broken English. And what they said to me, she said, completely changed how I look at things. Because they looked at her and they said, thank you. And then they smiled and said, we hold Jesus in our heart. We hold Muhammad, blessed be his name, in our head. And she said, she didn't know at first what they meant, until the following year or two, as she struggled with them in the injustices and the prejudice and the economic inequality situations and all the challenges of being a refugee. But what she understood over time was that what they had said, what they were affirming, was that Jesus' life, if you looked at his stories, if you looked at his life, it had always been about love. It had always been about inclusiveness. It had always been about justice. And they hold that in their heart, where Jesus is. But their faith was Muslim. It was an interesting thing, she said, and I want to read what she concluded with in her book. She said, the more I failed to communicate the love of God to my refugee friends, the more I experienced the love of God from myself. The more overwhelmed I felt as I became involved in the myriads of problems facing my new friends who experienced poverty in America, the less pressure I felt to attain success or wealth or prestige. And the more my world started to expand at the edges of my periphery, the more it became clear that life was more beautiful than I had been told. It seems to me that a big part of this story, that Jesus, this story with Jesus and the rich man, is not about giving up wealth. It's about what needs to be undone in our lives so that our stories can open up, so that our vision of the kingdom can open up. I've shared this little parable that I want to end with in the past, but a lot of you all may not have heard it when I did it before. This story of a man from Crete who was a patriot of Crete. He'd been born there, lived there, worked there, hardly ever left the island of Crete, was so devoted to his island that it was all he was. It was his blood, it was in his lifeblood, it was in his whole being. So that when he was dying, the one thing he begged for friends to do was that they would bury him with the soil that he clutched in his hand. So that when he did die, and they did bury him, he was still clutching the soil of Crete. Now, as the story goes, when he arrived at the gates of heaven, St. Peter was there to welcome him in. But as he approached the gate, he was still clinging to the soil. And St. Peter said, you can't come in. You got to let go of that. You can't come in. But he couldn't, of course. It was his life. It was everything. So he held on to it tighter, and he went out and he sat down outside the gate. And eons went by. And then after some time, some of his friends came out. They said, "You wouldn't believe what's here. You wouldn't believe it. It's amazing. Everybody is here. You should come in." He sounded excited. He got up. He started to approach the gate, but they saw that his fist was still clenched with the soil. And he said, "I can't let go of it. It's everything. It's too important." And so once again, he had to sit outside. And this went on for some time, different friends, different people, until finally a grandchild of his granddaughter came out, and she said, "Grandfather, why won't you come in?" And he said, "It's because they won't let me bring the soil of Crete, and the soil of Crete is everything to me. It is all my life. It is what I deeply believe in. It's everything." And she said, "Well, you've got to let go of that." And he said, "But I can't. It's too important." And she smiled and said, "It's really not that important." And she started to open his hands just enough that the soil began to slip through his fingers. And as she helped him up and began to usher him towards the gate, the rest of the soil dropped from his hands and he went through the gates of heaven. And on the other side was the island of Crete. To me, the most amazing thing, like what D.L. Mayfield experienced and what you all have experienced in your own lives, and what Charm really hinted at in that wonderful exercise, was this sense in which the tighter we cling to our notion of what the kingdom is, the tighter we cling to what our notion is about what belief and creeds and all of that is about spirituality, the smaller that is, the more we miss entirely in terms of God's kingdom. But only when we learn to let go of some of that, simply let go of it, simply engage with someone else, let go of the defensiveness, let go of the anxiety. When we are allowed to let go of the smallness, we begin to experience the largeness. You know, I don't remember if any of you remember the "What Would Jesus Do" bands. Hannah, your mom gave me yours. Hannah, it doesn't say "What Would Hannah Do," but it says "Hannah Kirby." I'm going to start wearing it. I'll wear it at least for today. Wow. So you remember that? And I know this isn't exactly what Jesus was saying, surely, but I sense this kind of text where Jesus is saying to this guy, "Well, what do you know what to do? You don't commit adultery, you don't murder, you don't steal, you've done the Ten Commandments." It's sort of like the "What Would Jesus Do" list. You know, if you ever find yourself in this problem, you're going like, "What would Jesus do?" But what those things miss is it's more like, "What would Jesus resist? What would Jesus be defiant about?" You know, we make this list of sort of moral and creedal statutes to define ourselves against others. But Jesus says, get rid of everything. Give it to the poor. Open yourself up. Be related to life, to one another, to creation. Experience the kingdom. Amen.
Coming home soon. Long as I can see the light. Pack my bag and let's get moving. 'Cause I'm bound to drift a while. Though I'm gone, gone, you don't have to worry, no, no. Lord, long as I can see the light. Traveling bone, 'cause I feel it won't leave me alone, but I won't be losing my way, no, no, long as I can see the light.
So I invite you all to stand, and we'll take one another's hands for our blessing. And thanks, band, and thanks so much again to Hannah Kirby. Everybody, we thank Hannah Kirby here. Hannah, I hope you'll come back and visit us, join us again. This was awesome. So take one another's hands, and let's have a blessing. I invite you to stick around a little bit afterwards. Also, Hannah, I think you have a few CDs here. You do have some. But you can also go to hannahkirby.com. And find out more information there, and stick around and visit with her. Let's have a word. Holy One, bless us as we go from this place. Help us to discover those things that we need to allow to be undone in our lives, those things that we are just clinging perhaps a little too tightly to, even the negative narratives that we live by, that we've created for ourselves. How many ways we block out your kingdom. Open us up that we might not simply experience the richness and the grandness, but that we might also be that light for others to see as they're making their way home. Bless us from this place. Amen.
Trail of desire through the dark.